And it was then that I realized his athleticism. It was then that I was able to see just how athletic he was and how much he reminded me of his father. Back then, he was just very awkward and very, like, wiry. And, you know, you could just tell that he had something in him and he just needed to cultivate it. And that's exactly what he did.
I knew I had a chance to go far in football when I was 6 years old. I played for Oakland Wildcats. That was my first year ever playing. Before then, I was just real big on basketball. You know, the Michael Jordan era. That's all I ever wanted to do was play basketball. But I picked up a football for the first time when I was six. And I played quarterback for Oakland. And my first game, I took two bootlegs up the sideline for a touchdown. Ever since then, I had league dreams on going to the NFL. So I just been working hard ever since I was 6 years old to get there. Right here at Simon's Playground, this is where it all started. I was 6 years old. I played for the Oakland Wildcats. I played 2 years of 55s, 2 years of 65s, 1 year of 75s. About Oakland, definitely
wouldn't
be where I'm at today.
Just like John Rankin, which is Jaelen's dad.
I didn't even notice that.
John had a competitive nature. Jaelen was born with it. And I can remember back from the time my son is actually, Sean, his cousin Sean, is actually just about a year and a half older than Jaelen. And our son started Sean playing football for the Mount Airy Bantams when he was 6 years old. Jaelen was just five at the time, just getting ready to turn five. Actually, he was four, getting ready to turn five. And I talked to John and we started talking about, you know, them in terms of starting them on competitive sports. What we did was, I was with the Mount Airy Bantams, Jaelen was with the Oakland Wildcats. So what we ended up doing is, after Jaelen's first year of playing, after his first couple of years of playing with the Oakland Wildcats, the Mount Airy Bantams organization, I talked to my brother, and I was like, listen, man, what would be more greater? Sean was one of the premier players at Mount Airy Bantams, and Jaelen was one of the most premier players at the Oakland Wildcats. And it was like, people thought it was like a merger of today, almost like a LeBron type move when Jaelen decided to leave the Oakland Wildcats and join the Mount Airy Bantams organization to play football. He did everything except the actual announcement that he was leaving Oakland. But once my brother called me and told me that he was going to put Jaelen on the Mount Airy Bantams football team, it was like a marriage made in heaven. You know, once he came over to Mount Airy. He began to run track and field in the off seasons, and that's when I could kind of like really see him taking extra strides in his athletic abilities. My brother was 6'7", about 245 pounds, straight muscle. And Jaelen just kind of like just started to grow in the image of his father. At an early age, and he was able to run track and field, and he was really good at the long jump. He ran the one, he ran the two, he ran the 400 meters, and it was at that time when he was probably around 8 or 9 that he started to kind of like really set himself apart from everyone else, and you could actually tell that his athleticism was just on a whole nother level.
After 5 years playing at Oakland, I did something a lot of people wouldn't agree with, but I came over to the Mount Airy Bantams, which is Oakland's arch rival. It's been that way for some years now. But I went to the championship 5 times at Oakland and couldn't get the job done, you know, so I came over to a better organization. And out of the 3 years I played,
I won two championships on the 90-pound team. We went 20-0 under Coach Kevin Norris. And then 105 year under Coach Earl, we went to the championship game, played against Oakland, but lost. But, you know, that being said, Monary has taught me so much, you know, with football aspect and, you know, growing up to be the young man I am today. Taking another route, DB. I mean, I'm a receiver, so we're gonna go at it. Oh.
Successful. My family, you know, that's number one. You know, they always been behind me ever since day one. They told me, you know, I could go to the NFL. You know, a lot of kids, they get asked, you know, what you gonna be when you get older, and they get laughed at when they say, you know, NFL player, NBA player. But ever since day one, my family never told me, you know, think of a plan B, or you know, they just told me to follow my dreams. You know. If I just work hard at what I do, it'll take me there. So they motivate me the most, you know, to be successful. Because I see how hard they work and how much they sacrifice to get me where I, you know, where I am today and where I can be in the future.
I probably knew Jay all my life. We grew up as brothers. His dad, my dad, his best friends, brothers. Cousins, all that shit. His dad was actually my godfather. And so, you know, that was, you know, probably coinciding with one another. So it was like, I mean, if my pop wasn't around, his pop wasn't around, so that was my pop. That's why I looked at him right there. He got the same tattoo right here and all that. So, you mean, that's how our friendship and our brotherhood was. We grew up. You know what I'm saying, to stick with one another and everything like that. You know what I'm saying? I was, four or five when Jay was born. So I used to, you know, watch him and all that. I was still young, you know what I'm saying? But I used to watch him. And, you know, as we got older, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't that far of a gap when we both started playing football. And that was my dog. Even still to this day, that's my dog. We was like rivals. He was playing for Oak Lane, I was playing for the Bantams. And you know, we both had names for ourselves, and you know, when we played each other, it was like a big showdown.
We'll be right back.
everybody who is successful in today's world, you know, has crossed their path with obstacles. You know, they've had hills to climb. You know, it's been, you know, emotional roller coasters. So one thing I learned about, you know, being successful is you can't give up. You can never give in. You know, it's always going to be something there to stop you. It's never going to be easy. It's always something to bring you down, it's to take your joy away, but you have to find ways around it. And one way I do that is, you know, I either pray or, you know, I go out into the field to work out or even turn on some music, you know, that motivate me. I never get down on myself. I know that, you know, God got a plan for me, just like He has a plan for everybody.
Right here in Monterey, better known in the Uptown part of Philadelphia, this is where I spent my whole life living here. 19 years of my life spent right here in this house behind me. Everything happened in this house. First basketball game, first football game, everything, you know, was brought up in this house. Haven't moved yet.
Yeah, when I first met Jaelen, it was like the summer of 8th grade going to 9th grade. Me and him, I met him through a friend at a dollar party. It was in West Philly too. And when I met him, me and him was the same height. But then, like, going to 9th grade year, he started to grow. And I played quarterback that year. He was supposed to be my go-to receiver, but they wouldn't give him any play. I don't know why. Sophomore year was when I started playing on varsity. Jaelen had the skills to play varsity, but they knew he was a pup and they wanted him to develop more. So then he didn't really play as much. But going to our junior year, the summer of our sophomore year, that's really when we separated ourselves from a lot of the people in the city. We was working out almost every other day. We went to countless amount of camps. DeBarlow, we had Coach Albie to help us. He one of the best coaches in the city.
High school at West Catholic in, you know, West Philadelphia. When I first got there and I was real immature, I was only 13 years old, starting 9th grade. And that was a big deal for me, you know, being in high school. You know, I was just attention seeker. I wanted to be the guy with all the girls. You know, I just didn't really have my mind in the right place. You know, I was talking back to teachers, doing all the wrong things. And that, you know, landed me in Conduct Summer School my first 2 years of my high school career. And then, you know, junior year, I got my conduct together, but I didn't bring the other part with it, which was schoolwork. I still, you know, was struggling in school. And the consequence I paid for that was, you know, going to summer school for French and chemistry. But senior year, I think, you know, was my best year ever, you know, even though I was, you know, trying to catch up and make up for the 3 years before, you know, for work and stuff, but that didn't work out too good. But the most memorable thing that happened senior year was my football team, West Catholic, you know, winning the state championship. And that meant a lot to us, you know. I caught 2 touchdowns that game in the first half, you know, 2 catches for 100 yards. As well, you know, there's other players on our team did a significant job, you know, to help us win 50-14. And that was, you know, the proudest moment of my life, one of the proudest moments of my life so far.
Thank you.
turn it up, yo. Get it.
When I was 9 years old, my father passed away from leukemia, which is a cancer. And he got sick around the time I was 7 or 8 years old. No, I really didn't understand what cancer was then. I just knew he was sick. He was in and out of the hospital. And he couldn't come to no more of my football games, you know. I mean, it had an effect on me, but I was so young that I really didn't understand as much, you know, what was going on. I just had a lot of questions. I just wanted to know why, what was going on. But then when I was 9 years old, my uncle and my cousin, Shiz, they came to break the news to me, you know, that my father was no longer here with us. And the effect it had on me was real bad. I became more angry at a lot of things. I would go to school upset. My temper would get carried away. I started doing poorly in school with grades, and I really didn't understand, even till this day I ask why, but some things, everything happens for a reason, and I just have to look at it like that, and take lessons from everything in my life. And even now, I'm just living for him, trying to get to the NFL for him, because that's what he would want me to do. Before he passed, he told me that, that he really wasn't worried about me because, I would be okay. I'll be fine. So, I just had to keep him proud and just do what I do best and play football.
A lot of times were really good. We did a lot of things as a family, birthday parties. John and I would always get our sons together, as well as with the rest of our buddies that were with our little group that we had called Just Why. And we would get together, all of us had sons, and we would get together with our sons and have all kinds of play days and athletic days when we would take them to the park and throw footballs and barbecue and just do all the things that, we really never had a chance to do because a lot of us didn't have our fathers in our lives. So it was real important that we did the best that we could do with our sons. And that was always a goal that we strived to complete. We had a real good life. And then during the year of 2003, actually started a year before 2002 when John, my brother, Jaelen's dad, he was diagnosed with leukemia, with cancer. And it was like a blow, almost to the whole city of Philadelphia because John was just that type of guy where he was very charismatic, very likable, lovable. And he got sick. And once he got sick, that really threw all of us off, especially myself, because we had so many dreams and aspirations that we wanted to complete with one another all the way back from the time that we played high school basketball against one another. And here we are in 2003, in the prime of our lives, man, when he was just 34 when he was diagnosed with this disease. And it was really a hard time because trying to explain, to Jaelen, here's this guy who was just a mountain of a man and was always able to just withstand anything and everything, who through this disease kind of like was just torn down, completely torn down. And it was really hard for us as a family to try to explain to Jay what was going on, that, you know, his dad wasn't, you know, strong enough, and he wasn't able to come to see his games as he once did. We would sit in the stands together and watch his games. But the cancer had really, you know, ate him up to the point that he wasn't able to even do that. And it was a trying time. And on April 4th of 2003, you know, he lost the fight. We all lost the fight, and he passed away. I wouldn't allow anyone else to come and break the news to my nephew except myself. And so, you know, as a unit, we would all be together. My son Sean, me and Jaelen and John would always get together and do things together. So I thought it'd only be befitting that on the day that John lost his battle with cancer, that my son and I, you know, travel to Jaelen's house and tell him the news. And when we did, you know, it was a very trying time. It was a very emotional time. It was a very hurtful time. And, you know, Jaelen was, you know, he really took things very, very hard. But at the same time, you know, he also understood, because my brother did prepare him and start to talk to him during the time that he got sick. He was telling him the things that he wanted him to accomplish in life. And from the start that Jaelen had, right up to this very day, I can honestly say that he's never missed a beat in terms of being able to carry out those plans that his father had for his life. And the hardest part about it is sitting in the stands and watching Jaelen as he runs up and down the football field. I'm sitting there where I once sat with my brother. And now, you know, my brother's not here, so I have to sit alone. But I find encouragement, you know, always when I look up. And one thing he always does, and he started doing it when he was in high school. Was every time he scored a touchdown. He acknowledges his father. And one day, I know the goal is going to be on Sunday afternoon when he makes the pros. So again, and always, knowledge is fine. All right.
Me and my boy Jaelen, all my other boys, we just like really determined to keep on grinding and push to the top. No matter what we doing, no matter if it's a job, no matter if it's one of us going to the league, I think all of us have a shot. It's just how hard we work.
Words of encouragement. Sky's always the limit for Jay, and even beyond. His athleticism, his attitude, his approach to the game, his approach to working out, and just his extreme passion, you know, and zeal for life. I could only see, you know, the very best happening for him in terms of football, and him being able to live out the same dream that I know that his father and I shared. And that's to one day see both our sons compete and play at the highest level that they can actually play at. And for Jaelen, that looks like it's going to be the NFL. So, you know, watch, y'all watch out for him. We already know what he do. We know, already know how he get down. Now y'all watch the show. Now it's time to watch the strong show.
Always remember, you got to stay humble in this game, man, because when one moment you can be real hot, then the next minute you can just sizzle and be absolutely nothing. You know, we look at examples, guys like T.O. Terrell Owens, when he played the game, man, he was the hottest dude out there when he was the Niners. And even when he came to the Eagles, he just kind of sizzled down a little bit when he was a Cowboy. But he was hot. He was flames. And now the dude can't even get a job. You know, and his ego, you know, he went from being the guy to just hopefully being a guy that can get into an arena, knowing a guy, you know what I'm saying? So this game goes by fast, man. You got to take advantage of the opportunities. You got to be able to roll with those. But when you're humble and you're a good dude, people will always make you relevant. You look at Michael Jordan. They're always going to make Jordan relevant because he's a good dude. He was an ambassador of the game. People loved him. People wanted to be like Mike. You know, so stay humble. Stay, you know, one thing I learned in this whole business is everybody's always striving to get to the next level. When you was in high school, you was striving to get to college.
Right.
And then when you got to college, you know, you want to be the best receiver, not only in the Pac-10, the Pac-12, but you want to be the best receiver in the country.
Right.
So then when you get to the league, this way it gets a little tricky. When you get to the league, you want to be hungry. You want to be that rookie that's getting on the field to be able to get, because you're going to get that first contract. That first contract going to be a little bit of money. But the second contract is that big money contract. That's the one that you're going to live off of. You know what I'm right. saying? That's the one that's going to be that thing. But after you get that second contract, you best believe they're trying to get rid of you. Instead of paying you $5 million a year, they're trying to find the next Jaelen Rankin.
Right.
Strong Rankin to come on. They could pay $400,000 to. You know what I'm saying? So you always got to stay humble. Be good, man. Just be good to yourself. Understand the bigger you get, the bigger your circle gets, but you got to find a way to keep your circle tight. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, look at guys, man, and look at Sharif Floyd. Everybody in Philly say they know Sharif Floyd. They did this for Sharif Floyd. They did that for Sharif Floyd. I met Sharif Floyd once or twice. I ain't, you know. But be leery about what people tell you or people are trying to make their name off of you. Be leery of those guys. You know what I'm saying? If somebody got to say, I know Jaelen, or I did this for Jaelen, you kind of stay back for them.
Right.
You deal with the people that you know they've always been there and they never going to ask you for nothing. Because just something ain't always going to be there if you don't do it the right way. And, you know, just keep the love of the game. Stay true to your books. Gotta graduate. I'm not telling you to graduate that thing with a 3.9. If you can't do it, great. Graduate. Get your degree. Let your money work for you. They're giving you a scholarship for $150,000. Let it work for you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I think Arizona's a beautiful place to raise a family. Great community out there. Safe environment. I think you'll thrive out there. You had a little bit of taste of the West Coast from being out of L.A. Pierce. I think that matured you as a man. And you know, we got a lot of love back here for you in Philly, you know. And I don't ever want you to feel like you lost that. But just keep doing what you're doing, man. And never think you got too much bigger for nobody.
Right.
You know, and always be smart. Always be smart.
Ultimate goal, you know, is just to be successful in life and whatever. You know, my plan is to go to the NFL and be one of the best receivers to ever play the game in the NFL. And I believe I can make it happen if I just stay true to myself, constantly work, you know, just do real good in the classroom as well as on the field. And I believe things will work out in my favor. Also, keeping God first, you know, that's a big thing to me as well, just constantly staying close to him because he makes it all happen.
Thank you.
finish. Oh.